Today we're going to be talking about the first derivative test. And let's look at this picture here. And notice that we know that we are increasing when our first derivative is positive. Now notice when the first derivative changes from positive to negative, we have a local maximum. And then our first derivative changes from negative to positive, our graph has a local minimum. And in these cases, these are critical points, but here we're undefined, also a critical point, and our derivative changes from positive to negative, we're going to have a maximum, and then we have no extreme, even though our derivative is zero, but our first derivative doesn't change signs, that's no extrema. So our first derivative test, and this is really important, is the following test applies to a continuous function. Keep that in mind. Our derivative or our function has to be continuous. So if our derivative changes from positive to negative, we have a local maximum. If our derivative changes signs from negative to positive, we have a local minimum. Now, if it doesn't change signs, we have no extrema. Often how I remember this is I remember an x squared graph, either smiling up or frowning. On either side of the vertex, here, our first derivative is less than zero, so decreasing, and then here, our first derivative changes to increasing. So I change from decreasing to increasing. I do like a little visual almost, and remember that we have a minimum. Now here we are increasing, our first derivative is greater than zero, increasing to decreasing, we have a maximum. Now at an endpoint, okay, we have a local maximum or minimum. So at an endpoint, we have a local max if your first derivative is decreasing on an interval, and then we have a local min if after that point our first derivative is increasing. And then at a right endpoint, if your first derivative is decreasing to the left of that endpoint, we have a minimum, and then if we're increasing to the left of that endpoint, we're going to have a maximum. Okay, let's do an example. Here's the first derivative test to find the local extrema. Identify any absolute extrema. One thing I want to highlight with you guys, local extreme values. That means we're looking for a y value. You can give me the point, I'm okay with that, but just keep in mind, value means a y number. Okay, so let's find our derivative. Set your derivative equal to zero, or look and see where your derivative is undefined to figure out any critical points. So I factor out a 3, x squared minus 9, I set my x squared minus 9 equal to 0. This is all the fun and exciting stuff you guys learned way back in Algebra 2. Okay, so these are our critical points. Since this quadratic is defined for all values, and even our first derivative is defined for all values, we have to look at negative 3 and positive 3. So make yourself a little sign chart. Negative 3 and 3, and label what that is. I found a few years ago, my students were having trouble labeling, and they were having trouble deciding what this was. So now you look at the sign. So each one of these stands for an interval. So numbers less than negative 3. So plug in negative 4 in your derivative. That's why we labeled that. If we plug in negative 4, you have to decide whether your derivative is positive or negative. So our derivative is positive for numbers less than negative 3. We are negative in between. I like to plug in 0. And then we are positive again. A lot of times it's going to go in this pattern, but not always. Okay, so Here, now we want to find the extreme values. So we want to find f of negative 3. F of negative 3 is 57. So we have a max of 57 at x equals negative 3 because f prime of x changes from positive to negative. Now, I'm going to ask you guys to justify your answer. Writing this statement right here is justifying your answer. Okay, now let's find f of 3, and I found f of 3, and I got negative 51. This is a min of negative 51. Again, I'm highlighting the y value at x equals 3 because f prime of x changes from negative to positive. And again, this statement is our justification. I'm going to be looking for this. This sign chart, yes, is showing me your work, but that's not enough justification for me. And just looking at this regular function, we know this function looks something like this, a regular f of x function. So there's no absolute extrema. Okay, use the first derivative test to identify local extreme values. Okay, so again, find your first derivative. This is a product rule. Derivative of the first, leave the second alone, plus leaving the first alone, derivative of the second. Set this equal to 0 and factor out what's in common. So an x, an e to the x, and I'm left with a 2 plus x. So my critical points... 1 factor equal to 0, e to the x equals 0. This never happens, so we don't have to worry about that one. Setting the last factor equal to 0, we get x equals negative 2. Now again, set up your sign chart. And you might want to label this the sine of f prime, just so that you know what you're looking at. We have a 0. Actually, no, negative 2 is less than 0. So let's put that there. Okay. Plugging in, say, negative 3 into your second derivative. I would plug it into this simplified version and just look at whether or not your terms are positive or negative. Here I would have a negative. This would always be positive. This would be negative. So I have a negative times a positive times a negative. So that's going to be a positive number. If I plug in negative 1, negative, positive, positive, so we're negative. Plug in 1, positive, positive, positive. So I go from positive to negative. When I go from positive to negative, I have a max of something at x equals negative 2 because f prime of x changes from positive to negative. To get the actual value, plug in negative 2 in here, and I get 4 over e squared, and then we have a min of, when I plug in 0, I get 0, min of 0, because f prime of x changes from negative to positive. Okay, now let's talk about absolute extrema. So let's look here. Let's look at the limit as x goes to negative infinity of our function. As I go to negative infinity, this goes to some positive number, but this gets really, 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 really close to zero. My limit as x goes to positive infinity of my function, I'm guessing it's going to be really big number times by a really big number. So this is going to be some really also big number. So even though the limit gets infinitely close to zero, it never gets to zero. So that's why this would be considered an absolute extrema. In our next example, this is a particle question, and particle questions play into this. So particles moving along the x-axis. Find the velocity and acceleration and describe the motion of the particle. Okay, so we find our velocity, remember, is the derivative of position. So I have 8t minus 6t squared. I set that velocity equal to zero and factor to get t equals 0 4/3. Let's also find our acceleration function as long as we're here taking derivatives. So I take my derivative of my velocity function. Okay, so for your velocity function, let's assume, now they didn't tell us this, but let's assume it's t is greater than or equal to 0. I would probably write that on there for you guys. So we have 0 and we have 4/3. What you want to do is you want to get the sine of v of t, because that tells us which direction we're moving. So if I plug in 1 into my velocity function, this would be positive, and this would be positive, so I'm positive, which means I'm moving to the right. When I say I plug in 2, we have a positive times a negative, which means I'm moving left. So to describe your motion, let's get a little typing thing up here. Okay, so give me the initial position when t equals 0. So the particle's initial, I can't spell today, position is at 3 from 0 to 4/3. The particle is moving right at t equals 4/3, the particle changes directions and moves left for t is greater than 4/3. And that's how you describe particle motion. Okay, please for me, make sure the lesson summary, which is below this video, is submitted on time.